doing inspections.
I just literally
load them down.
Yeah. All right, we're ready to go again. Would you like to introduce this, Mark?
Sure. At each school board meeting, we ask our representatives from our two high schools to give us an update on the things that have been going on over the last month with each high school. And then we have a topic. This month's topic is advanced placement programming. But I'll turn it to Brookfield East and then Brookfield Central. Why don't you guys go ahead and give us an update on what's been going on at both of our high schools? Or we'll start with Central. Go ahead. Brookfield East update.
Okay, so a club at our school that was newly introduced called History and Music Color. It spreads awareness about historical periods of oppression and genocides. Our Hope Squad is spreading positive messages outside the lunchroom, and they work on awareness about school mental health. Our C Club just helped our lunchroom transition to reusable metal utensils. And our debate club has two qualifiers for LD going to the NSCA National Tournament in Albuquerque, New Mexico. And then we just had our annual showcase, which spread awareness about the crisis in the U.S.
For our arts highlights, we had a successful band concert on the 8th, and our Willy Wonka performance was nominated for the Tommy Awards. And for athletic highlights, Joey Krasinski on the football team was named Cole's All-American Kicker of the Year. Rachel Scott was our Brookfield East Athlete of the Week, and because she averages 50 points per game as a rotary player for the team. The boys' swim team has a record of 3-1 in the weeks, and they were just at Marquette in boys, which they're going to have scoring at. And the JV and varsity wrestling team competes against the rival Marquette.
Have our annual athleticathon this Saturday. Finals will be coming up, and the sports on lunch. I'll have families to do. Their classroom co-chairing, especially in the
As I said, our topic for this month's discussion is advanced placement. Board members, there are the four questions that I assume you guys had a chance to talk with your classmates about. I'm just going to open it up in general. What did you learn as you talked with your classmates about advanced placement? What can you tell us about your own experiences with advanced placements? Open for anybody starting.
And this
potential for college when students go back to AP classes for because they don't have to get to college.
A lot to unpack there. What else did you guys learn as you talked to your classmates?
Students gave us feedback that, and I can second this statement, by like AP classes should be more open to the 8-day BA schedule because that like allows students, that gives students an extra day to do homework in that class, and it's also spread out throughout the whole year instead of crammed into one semester where teachers actually like lose quite a bit of time to teach the course material, so they often have to hold review sessions in the next semester outside of class to finish the course. So
what I think I heard was look at skinnies, try to build as many skinnies as possible.
Yeah.
That's where it's offered every other day. And then the other thing I think I heard was, is it three-term AP opportunity for some of our more content-driven courses like Chem and US and stuff like that? Those themes that you guys heard? Okay.
Yeah, there are also some pros. So a lot of kids love that it does, it's a new type of thinking, so it does prepare you for when college comes around, and it offers a nice boost and an opportunity to get money or college credit, which saves money for college.
So. One of the biggest adjustments I've done is, like they were saying, with the, a lot of them not being 8-AP, they kind of go back in May. And, if you had an AP class for a semester and study all the material again for the AP exam on top of maybe all the other classes, all the classes that you have going second semester, just
any other learning or suggestions that you picked up on, folks? Board members, any questions?
Well, you are a small sample size, but I'm going to ask a question. You talked about a three-term option, and you also talked about a four-term skinny option. If you were to choose your own preference between the skinnies and a three-term option, how many of you would prefer the skinnies? Guess I don't have to ask the other question. Interesting.
Scott.
I have a few questions, and this might be answered by Mike. I'm not sure. I know we've got some block schedule challenges. How many AP classes do we have offered on that year-long schedule? Is it just the couple that Dr. Hansen mentioned?
It's just a small handful, and usually dependent on student interests of those students that are in other AB classes, particularly in music.
So putting it opposite music for the year. And then my second question, would that challenge go away if we had an August school start time? Would it be easier to get year-long AP classes? Or is it still a problem of finding an opposite course?
If we had earlier start time?
Yeah, like started in August versus September 1st.
Might give us some flexibility to offer more AP courses during the spring terms. You know, one of the reasons we aren't able to offer a ton of AP courses in terms 3 and 4 are because the AP exams start May 15th, and so you lose some instructional days there. So it might provide some relief there.
And then, what does it take to get more classes that can be offered on that skinny schedule? Is it really just music? Have we looked at languages?
Yep, done all of that. Yeah, we probably have more AB offerings right now than we've ever had. But it's clear based upon feedback that even more would be better.
Yeah.
So.
Because it's often like paired with music. And we really kind of like pushing to have it just like two AB classes bouncing off each other. Because like that would be really easy to balance. Just like for the purpose of like having it with like a fine, like an arts class.
But we still have the challenge of those days after May 15th.
You would, sure. For any year long course, yep.
Yeah. I have three out of the four blocks and now I see long courses. First block I have launch. Second block I have two skinny courses. I have anything else maybe. And those two classes, like in particular, I really enjoy having them committed because research is pretty good. They only offer it as the alternating course because it's, you need a lot of class time.
Words chosen really carefully. Those words were chosen really carefully. That was well done.
But we normally, the everyday class would have a class essay every week. But for us, we have every other week, which just makes it much more manageable. Third block, I was helpful.
My last question is probably for our student representatives. What can we do about the culture, the pressure to take an AP class if a student didn't feel ready? I mean, hopefully they're counseling with their counselors and their parents and things, and so you would imagine that not very many kids would find themselves in that over-their-head situation, hopefully, but I understand the pressure of culture in college, so what can we do in your minds to change that?
Actually doing a really, really good job. I think it really depends personally on like your friend group and also like the classes that you've been taking since like you came in through middle school. Because like let's say you might be like one grade level or two grade levels ahead already in a subject that like pushes you to be in that class like throughout high school. And like as you like are in those more challenging classes typically, I feel like a lot of students like hold this mindset going into high school as well that they need to kind of live up to like a standard like that they had initially set for themselves. So like it's like definitely difficult, and I think the school is doing a good job, but I think it boils down to like a lot of other factors that like can't be controlled necessarily in the moment. But like as like the school I think continues to develop the culture of accommodation and like the idea that it is okay to like focus on like yourself and what is right for you, I think like it will become like better as time.
Yeah, I'm breaking away from the stereotype of always trying to take as many AP as possible. Like that's gonna be hard, and like you would have to start at a young age saying like it's okay. But also even for kids that want to but don't know if they're ready enough, like making it known that like with more like skinny course options, and you can like alternate that with a study hall, because a lot of like what's about AP is like homework, like everyone like 2 extra hours on the night because they're taking classes. And so like if you have a study hall and classes only that's 90 minutes to do the homework. So like having that known or being able to alternate like an AP class with like a study hall would definitely help like lessen the kids.
Could our student leaders help message that to freshmen when they come into high school? And maybe in terms of the culture and some suggestions based on your experience saying, hey, pick those areas that are of interest. Hey, think about the study hall option. Hey, maybe.
I think that's what the course fair is trying to do.
Yeah.
Some of you participated in that last year, maybe not this year, but each of our high schools run a simultaneous course fair where the students rotate around the building to 9 or 10 different stops.
Yeah.
To hear about that department's course offerings, and if they have career interests, these are the courses they should take. It's a newer tradition. I think this is the second year we've done that. Pick it, right? Right.
Allison?
Just a personal question. Do you feel like you, thinking of the college you want to go into or go to, do you feel like you kind of have to take the AP classes in order to get into those colleges?
I feel like I want to apply probably to and talking to my counselor. You have already graduated and done the college. I don't know, I mean, even though I got into engineering, I don't know if I would have chosen to take physics B. But I feel like I want to be competitive in the admissions process and everybody else in physics B.
Question?
Jim?
Well, I think your younger generation getting smarter and smarter. I remember 10 years ago, almost no students take like AP class in freshman year. Take one or two in the sophomore. Now, freshmen kids take AP. That's kind of common, right? That's not my question. My question for you is, I know many of you took AP class, but not necessarily take AP test. And what make people do not take AP test? Because it's too hard or get lower grades or not able to get higher score in AP test or other reasons?
Take the AP class as a GPA booster, so they don't care as much about the AP test, but then also some people would think that they struggled in the class and they don't think that they would be well prepared for the AP exams, so they don't want to put the money in and then not pass the exam. The two main avenues, I think, for the reasons why students don't do.
I think a third factor is that some of our universities, including the biggest one in Wisconsin, is starting to roll back the acceptance of AP scores for college credit. There's a whole tuition loss.
It's a big thing. And also with that, you have to be able to score, like, now since it's getting more difficult, like, oftentimes a 4 or 5. And, like the APs that, like, they would accept that in are already more, like, rigorous APs, like, calc or like physics or like in the sciences. So I think like for me, like I've chosen not to take certain AP exams for not just that reason, but for the reason that like, for example, like AP psychology, they probably may not count that as a credit. In like
so there's no universal application of advanced placement success across our universities and colleges. In fact, in the UW system, each university has it up to their own decision-making authority to decide if AP Psych is going to get credit for general credit for majors. Each university gets to decide that themselves. So then they have to chase which schools they want to go to and what courses will be accepted and build the schedule their junior and senior year based upon that.
Glenn?
Many years ago, before I was on the board, one of the interests of the board was to encourage more participation in AP classes, and so weighted grades were introduced as an incentive to do that. Mr. Wheeler talked about, you know, what are the things that might cause kids to take on more than maybe they should. Suppose weighted grades were taken away. How would that impact students taking AP classes? And think about your own self. Would you take fewer AP classes if weighted grades were taken away?
I think that that would, like, take away from taking what are considered, like, easier APs, and that can be based off of, like, the topic of the class. That can also be based on the teacher who's teaching the class. But I definitely think that that would take away from taking some APs that they would just take for, like, an extra.
I know people who are maybe going to go to Dalton and they're taking APs, and some thus they get the GPA research and not because like they're interested in taking the test. It's just, it's at the point where people may have 8 APs or 7 APs in a year, and there's so many people with that that then they have to go and take them in the summer to get ahead of those people. So it's like, I think so many people have started to take them, and it's just become,
well, thanks for your time tonight. Really appreciate your information. You guys are welcome to stay, of course.
We know finals are next week.
Go home and study. Good. Thanks, guys. Have a great night.
Good luck on finals.
The next item on the agenda this evening is the Citizens Forum, an opportunity to address the board on matters that do not otherwise appear on the agenda. We have one request to speak. Angie, would you like to come forward and tell us whether you're a resident?
Special education. And I want to kind of talk about the things that we just learned from our AP students, their improvements and their strengths in that program. And kind of want to do that a little bit with our special education program in the district. Some of our strengths, we have an amazing staff. Our staff here at Elmbrook Schools is top notch. They really do care about our students and we really do want to help them succeed. The other really great thing we have at Elmbrook Schools for kids with significant disabilities, for older children, we have Fairview South. Fairview South is a wonderful opportunity for those kids that need it. But we have a lot of things that we could be improving in our district. I think about the opportunities that are lost every day for our younger kids, the kids that really would benefit the most from intense interventions. You know, there are no options for them. They're put into a general education classroom, whether they can handle being in that classroom or not. And I still wonder, after 2 years of coming to board meetings now, what happened to our continuum of placement? And is that something that we need to revisit and discuss and make improvements to our program? Because what ends up happening if these younger kids don't get the services and the interventions that they need, they become older kids that end up at their house. But if they would have had these opportunities, that are lost, would they have needed them? And that's something we can't figure out. You know, we don't know if those options do not exist. Right. And I think that you'll start to see that other school districts are figuring this out too. In fact, School District of Madison just spent $4 million approving a self-contained program in a special building for their elementary and middle school students, solely for those age groups, which is just, given the environment we're in, is unheard of. But I think that people are starting to see that we're losing these special ed kids. We're losing the opportunities that we had to make differences in their lives. We're missing the opportunity to give them the skills that they need so that they don't end up having to go to a Fairview South. Please, be clear. I have nothing against Fairview South. I have nothing but positive things to say about that place. But had my son had other options, would he need it today? And that's something I don't know. And I think that as a board, that's your job and your obligation to the people of this community is to really investigate whether we're doing a service or a disservice with our special education program and look for opportunities to strengthen it. And I encourage you to do that. I want you to do that. It's a
you, Angie. Next item on the agenda is the consent agenda. Are there items board members would like to pull?
I would like to pull item F, recent gifts to the district, and move approval of consent agenda items A through E.
Second.
Is there a discussion of approving items A through E? All in favor of the motion, please say aye.
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 Opposed? That carries. Scott, item F.
Direct your attention to the screen, which has recent gifts to the district for September 2019. And again, we'd just like to take a moment to thank the many businesses and individuals that gave financial donations. And we know that there's even more. They gave donations of time and talent to the district. The gifts totaled a dollar amount of $47,353.30 in the month of September. And again, just a big thank you to our community partners, because educating our students is a community effort, and we appreciate all the help. And with that, I move approval of consent agenda item F.
We have a motion. We have a second. Is there a discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That carries. First action item this evening is the 2020-2021 open enrollment seats. Kristen.
Every January, the board is required to declare the number of open enrollment seats available in the district. Due to increasing enrollment the past several years, the board has declared no available seats. The recommendation again this year is, due to our resident enrollment, to not declare any open enrollment seats for the next year. I've received no questions since the last board meeting on this topic.
Allison.
I move approval of the recommendation that no new open enrollment seats be made available for the 2020-2021 school year.
Second.
Thank you. Is there a discussion? All in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That carries. Next, the computer science principals, UBD, Mike.
This evening, we're seeking approval of a slight adjustment to our AP Computer Science Principles curriculum. We had discussed this at our last board meeting. The adjustment is really to take that course from a half-credit course with a prerequisite to a full-credit standalone course.
Jen?
You might, maybe, this is kind of a learning question about the AP versus US UBD. On this particular class, I heard from the kids, it was like you have like a two semester class and help them to do the AP exam at the end, like in May. So I wonder about UBD, assuming AP, they have a requirement, right? They have contents, and chapters and contents, and then UBD, of course, you do something similar, which can you share with us the differences between, say, AP requirements versus UBD?
Yeah. So anytime we have an advanced placement course that we're offering, that curriculum is actually created by members of the College Board, the organization that puts forth advanced placement courses. What we do so that all our curriculum can be communicated in a similar form is we take their outcomes, and essentially their curriculum, and we just put it into our form so that when board or community members look at our curriculum, there's one standard approach to viewing that.
So if I understand correctly, is there not much differences in terms of level of difficulties, but more like format, the way you need to the way so
correct.
People can.
Scott.
Two things. I'd like to thank Mike and his team for the work on this. We have a great computer science program, maybe the best in Southeast Wisconsin in terms of where kids can go with this program, and I think this change will make the entrance into these courses easier at the high school level, so I'm in strong support of that. For that reason, I'd like to move approval of the AP Computer Science Principles UBD as presented.
A second.
Is there further discussion? All in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? That is approved. Next on the agenda, we have the ones that we're moving, administrator contracts and preliminary renewal. Kristen?
Each January, we bring before you recommendations for administrative contracts for the next year. This year, we're recommending 32 administrative contracts on the list of the group in the background. That any questions or asking?
Jen?
This learning question again. 32 FTE for this category. That something every year change or based on, or is same as
this
for last 10 years, 5 years?
This
or
is the same as last year, the last several years. Any changes will be brought forward during the budget process.
Okay, so how would you categorize administrators versus other position? Okay. Not sure. I think, Randy, your name is here, right? And you see it. I'm assuming here. So how is that a school administrator, like a principal, a certain principal?
So some are state statute driven, and some are just the way this district has handled certain positions within the district. Some are type of licensing, and some aren't. It's a combination of those things.
Allison?
I move approval of the 32 administrator contracts as presented.
Second.
Thank you. Is there discussion? Scott?
One more question, if you can just jog my memory. I noticed it's a rolling two-year contract. We renew this every year. They're in there for 2 years. Is there, just remind me of what happens if an administrator moves to another district in the middle of this two-year contract. Is it a financial thing? I mean, what's in terms of the breaking of the contract? I just don't remember the details.
We do have language within the contract for liquidated damages, depending on the timing of the notice. If they notice us prior to, I believe it's March 1st, there isn't liquidated damages because we feel like we have time to post and hire prior to that start date. That is, if they notice us and finish the year. If they were to notice us later than that and not finish the year, there would be liquidated damages.
So a follow-up question then, what's the benefit to a two-year rolling contract versus an annual renewal or some other form?
The benefit is really, you know, you're giving a sign of confidence to your administrators.
Which we love you, and I see some of you in there.
I think it's really appreciated by the administrators to have that. Obviously, we have a lot of discussions throughout the year on performance, and that's ever a concern. Have those conversations, but this is just a small way to our administrative relationship.
Glenn.
And I apologize for not asking the question before. Suppose there is a reason, whatever the reason might be, in the second year to not want the second year to be fulfilled. Is the district still obligated financially to the employee for the second year as well?
So
how's that handled?
There's a timing, so we would have to notify administrators by the end of January of preliminary notice of non-renewal. So if there was an administrator that we didn't feel, we had some concerns about, they would be on this list, and we'd have those conversations and we'd notice them prior to January 31st. So there are some timelines that we have to adhere to, which is why we bring these forward in January. So we either have to notify them by January 31st for their contract in the last year.
And if they are notified, then that second year obligation is gone?
Right. If there's a notification, then final. But if we had any concerns, you know, we do the 2 year. If we had any concerns this year, right, we would not include that administrator on this list. So they would be entering their second year, and it would send a clear message. Everyone else received renewal, we have some concerns with one of the administrators. So we do still have flexibility within this process, I think. It should be.
Thank you.
Is there more discussion? Hearing none, all in favor of approving the preliminary contract renewals, please say aye.
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 Opposed? That carries. Press box and stadium lighting, Kristen.
Board of Education approved a turf and track project back in October, and at that meeting, we had a discussion about the press box and the lights and needing just some additional information regarding those two items. We did receive a structural report on the press box and some other additional information regarding the lights. It was discussed at F&O, and the F&O committee unanimously approved a repair of the press box and replacement of the full lighting poles and everything at both locations. Dan Davis is here from C.T. Schmidt, along with Randy Johnston, our director of facilities, and he is going to go through a short presentation on some of the rationale behind that decision at F&O.
Dr. Hansen, could you get the lights?
So just as a reminder, we are in the process. So we came back, if you want to go to the next slide, we have a portion of the project with the turf, track, and field events, and the rest of the work already approved. And we're just here asking for the adding to that total for the press box and lighting plans.
You should have a calibration somewhere.
So the press box, the first thing we talked about, there was an option discussed quite a while back to replace, this is just at Central, by the way, replace the press box. We talked about it. It could be done. It is separate structurally from the bleachers, but at this point it was decided it was a better decision to wait, put a little money into it, and then wait until the bleachers are at the end of their life and coordinate that installation. And the athletic director and principal agreed with that. And so the structural repair welding and repair of the steel and last painting across this. So there's some detail behind this showing kind of what's going on. It's a report that was done by the engineer. So that's in your packet as well. This is the rust showing, and there's a couple of spots in the next slide where it's really bad. Separate action items or not. Then we looked at the replacement of the lighting. We had brought numbers to the board the last time we met to talk about this. The F&O committee went through it. The reason we're doing it is really to bring the light level up to current standards. It's important to be able to see the football. Particularly in Central, the lighting levels are way below what standard design requirements would. Obviously, they're with LED fixtures. There's a couple benefits to that. They're lower energy use. The more use that you're going to have is important. And they're very, very focused on the lenses and the LED fixtures themselves. So they will spill over the neighborhood a lot less and have a lot less glare. So that's a nice side benefit because that's important to the neighbors. Right now, there's one of the poles at Virtual East that literally in the middle of the bleachers. And talk about replacing the hole or not. And that was one of the benefits of it. Now, not interrupt the bleacher. We do wait. There were some costs associated with it, but it would also interrupt the use of the fields during that time to replace the hole. And we also recognize with the F&O that this lighting scheme that's there now is allowed by a special exception ordinance and has to go back and change. So we've made application to the city for these three reasons. To match the time of operation, which would match now with how we actually use the fuel, as opposed to the 30-year-old ordinance that didn't allow quite as much time as they use it now. And lighting wattage is stated at a height of a maximum of 45 feet in the city, so we're up at was allowed in 84 and 75 another campus. And they're going to pull same design, four light poles, 8 feet high, same wattage, same fixture. So they talked quite a while about whether we should reuse the poles. The poles are 20 plus years old. They do need to get inspected on a regular basis. There's a cost associated with that. There is some cost associated with postponing discussion, we started to add up all the money to replace the poles, inspect the poles, and the inflation that you have to replace them. It's actually less money total to replace them. That's for the don't have to inspect those poles. And just some other information that was in your packet as well. This is kind of a before and after on a field in Pennsylvania that Muscle Lighting was done. So this is before and this after. So there's, it's quite dark around the perimeter. You'll notice the difference back and forth. So in fact, we've had to add some light poles around the perimeter of the field, just the lighting levels on pathways and pedestrian ways. There are fields that the team is towards, the athletic director, obviously, is both walks on north and south. You can see how it looks when you're done. It really makes the field look great. Watch on west, north, and south. These are the existing pole locations, and they would all end up kind of on either side of the bleachers. Not too far away from where they are now, it's at central. So that's where we are now. And at east, you can see the one that's in the middle of the bleachers. That'll go over to the left. A little bit further, closer to about 15 yards on capital. This is some of the data that pointed to kind of the 50 foot candles in the middle of the field. You can see, especially down at Brookfield Center. It's just the data from the design criteria that says essentially this is a class 2 field which dictates the 50 foot candles.
Just had a question. Are we going to need lighting like the other school did so that we can see where we're walking?
Yes, and there are some poles that we're going to have. We have 6 poles at one campus and 7 at the other. Or which is which, but yes,
that's
there
right,
are some poles
right,
that light the walk.
Okay.
Yep. So the poles are inspected. They were serviceable, but the amount of money to maintain them actually wasn't even that equation. Get it inspected. But they've been there for quite a while.
Scott.
I didn't see, moving back to the beginning, I just didn't want to interrupt your presentation, back to the press boxes. I saw some information about the press box at central. Is the press box at east in good shape?
Yes.
So nothing needed there, and or would we do the same thing where when the bleachers are replaced, we'd look at it?
Yeah, at that point you would again.
Are both schools on the same bleacher replacement schedule? I mean, now the turf fields are going to be similar. I don't know if this is looked that far in our 10-year plan.
It's close. I think they're both close.
Yeah, they're both close. Yeah.
The exception of the bleacher bleachers and
central.
The whole bleach is the whole time. Yeah, that's what the press box.
Those are in the plan.
Right. But what was the exception on the visitor bleachers? I didn't
know. Those are both fairly new.
Oh, okay.
So the visitor bleachers we would have to revisit for 20 plus. Yeah.
Where are the heated seats at? Where are the heated I don't, when I go to a football game I haven't found those yet. So. So anyway, that's, I don't know what the cost is, but I'm joking about it. So that's fine.
Well, between the two, we're asking to increase the overall budget, $772,000 for light poles and lights and fixtures. It's $22,000 plus the $757,000.
Allison?
I just wanted to say thank you to everybody that was involved in this long process and for all of the work that you guys have done and the thought that you put into it. And with that, thank you. I would like to move to approve 22,000 structural repair and painting of existing press box at BCHS and approve $750,000, $750 for full replacement of stadium lighting at BCHS and BHS, including new poles, heads, and fixtures as a part of the turf and track replacement project.
Second.
I would just point out that in the budget approval that we did the last board meeting or whenever we did it, we did approve fencing contingent upon determining how much fencing should be used. And so although it's listed here as an approved turf and track project, those numbers are still to be reviewed by F&O when we get some additional information.
Yeah, the schedule for that would be to bring we have bids going out, there are plans going out the door here the next week, back in front of F&O, actual price and some value engineering.
Okay. Also, I think everybody knows I've been very concerned about spending $750,000 to replace 8 light poles that to this point are not unsafe. But when we did the analysis at Finance and Operations, and I don't know, we must have spent an hour talking about it. And thank you, Dan, for the analysis that you and your people did to took a look at the other costs over the long term. And so I'm also comfortable with the recommendation.
We have a motion and a second.
Another question, I don't know. You guys, well, no, I don't know who would answer this question. So, it's a lot of money, certainly, but I know the lights are necessary for evening use of sports. And one of the reasons that we're switching to a turf field is because it's not just going to be used by football players and football practice, but it'll be used for, I assume, band and cheer and lacrosse and soccer. Can you just speak a little bit to the teams that will play and practice on the field and kind of what the scheduling in terms of how far in the evening is this the kind of thing where we put in these fields and in the fall it's going to kind of be used from after school till 9 o'clock at night, or obviously in the fall we're losing a lot of daylight, so that's where the lights come in handy.
Could be. We're asking for use from dusk till about 10 p.m. Revision of the ordinance, and we can look to Central to see how often their field is used, and they probably use it Monday through Saturday every night of the week. We anticipate that it will be able to use that across soccer, band, gym classes, football, sports, community programs. It'll just be expanded.
Do our community programs get to use the football fields?
Yeah, if we have a rec soccer, we'll be able to use it, depending upon scheduling and availability of all of the different groups that we want.
On Sunday became Central's. Turf became a backup field for Elmbrook United. With all of their regional and Olympic team development teams, they didn't have a dry field in town. So they moved everything to Central. So they'd play 4 to 6 games on a Sunday there. And I will have 2 of those facilities for greater community-wide use.
Ordinance will allow the lights on Sunday.
Great.
Well, and just because of that, and this project obviously is expensive, but it is an investment in quite a few different sports. It's an investment for the community, and I think one of the ways to really capitalize on the investment is the lights, and it will be a nice benefit to the neighbors, especially while the lights will be on more often. Just to see those pictures of how dark it is near the field with that directional lighting. It's going to be better lighting on the field and then darker nearby, which I think is just a win. So I'm also in support of it.
You ready to vote? All in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? That carries. Now I'm going to ask for your patience with 2 more adjustments to the agenda. First one, I'd like to go to item D, student fees, so that Kristen can keep an appointment elsewhere.
At the last board meeting, we discussed the second phase of our approach to try to reduce fees and the burden on our parents. Last year, or actually this year, you may remember that we eliminated course fees. For next year, we're looking at eliminating the Nature Center fees, rounding registration fees just to make it more efficient, eliminate elementary club fees, eliminate middle school individual user fees, clubs, music and drama and athletics, and assess a one-time fee of $40. Eliminate high school individual user fees for clubs, forensics, debate, music and drama, and assess a one-time fee of $60. at the previous board meeting, the administrative recommendation was to change the high school athletic user fee to a one-time $120 fee. After discussion at the board, the decision was made to reduce that to $80 and eliminate the solo ensemble in the middle and high schools. All of these changes would result in decreased revenue of about $57,000 for the district. I haven't received any questions since the last board meeting, so with that, I'd ask for any questions or approval on this.
Can we start with a motion? Glenn?
I move approval of the 2020-21 school fees and revisions to policies as presented.
I second.
Is there discussion of the motion? Glenn?
Big picture question, Kristen. Before we started this fee deduction thing, approximately how much were we collecting annually in student fees?
$1 million. All fees. Of course, the parking fees, registration fees, all.
$2 million in?
Just district fees.
Right. And we have, as a result of last year's and now this year's recommendation, how much will we have reduced that by?
$257,000.
More than 10%. Thank you.
Allison?
Is this part of the work that you did, Glenn, in looking at fees with Kristen? Is this part of the work of lowering some of the burden on our families?
Not sure. Are you asking me a question?
Yes.
What is the question again?
Is this part of the work that you and Kristen did at looking at fees to see where we could lessen the burden on families?
Oh, absolutely. Although the heavy lifting is over here, so. To say that I worked with her as we, I talked to her about it, but Kristen and her people did the heavy lifting.
Well, thank you to both of you.
And we're not done, I don't think. I think there are other fees that are not district fees, but that parents pay either through support of a team or whatever. And I think that's, to me, that's also another concern that we don't. We currently watch it happen, and I think for some families, it keeps kids from participating, and so we're looking at that as well.
All right, we have a motion to approve the reduction in student fees.
Second.
We already have a second.
No. Third.
All right, we know how you're voting. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That carries. And now the final adjustment comes with profuse apologies, Angie. I did not register that this was part of the consent agenda, and she asked to speak to us after we had discussion on the consent agenda.
Thank you for approving the Wauwatosa County Special Education Consortium. As you all know, this is something that's very important to the families at Fairview South. The parent organization, the Friends of Fairview South, meets regularly to discuss the status of our school, our enrollments, and whether this agreement is going to continue from year to year. One of the ongoing items that families have asked me to talk to you about is, again, whether you would consider extending the agreement for more than 1 year. I know that you like to structure the agreement with a one-year period so that you can seek district participation and get those numbers and have a better idea, but that can still be done, even if the agreement does go for more than 1 year. They'll ask for that data on an annual basis. So as families question whether that's something that can be done or something that just hasn't been discussed. So the families would like you to look into that and consider extending the agreement for longer than 1 year. Because when we look at the school, we looked at the data that you presented, or that Tanya presented last meeting, that compared Fairview to the other two schools for special needs kids in the area, the Genesee Lake School and the Richardson School. And we noted that our school, and both of those schools, for students that are attending with a one-on-one, which is what you see typically in Fairview South. So it leads us to question, if our cheaper. And I know I personally talked to you last time about why our school is better than both of those institutions. If we're better and we're cheaper, why aren't we getting some of these new students? Why is our enrollment continuing to develop? There has to be a reason for that. And the only thing that we can come up with as a parent group, without having all of the data that you have, that people have some erroneous sense that this school isn't going to be. We really need you to fix that. Kids need that school. You need to know as families that our kids have options and they have placements that are going to meet their needs, that are within our own community and not 20 minutes or 30 minutes away out in Oconomowoc. And we want to know that our kids are with families that are similar in nature to Brookfield and Elmbrook communities. So it's really important to us that the school stay around. It's got a long history of being a successful institution that has helped many, many kids meet the best potential that they possibly can. And there's something going on that's causing this enrollment drop that we don't understand, and maybe you understand it, and we just don't have access to that data. But if we're cheaper and we're better, where are those kids going? So we think it's time that somebody asks that question and takes some action to help the families and the kids that go to the school to give us the certainty that our school will be there next year and the year after that if our child continues to do it. And right now we don't have that certainty. And as a parent in this district, I feel like I'm entitled to that certainty, just as you are entitled to know that Brookfield Central is going to be there with some great new lights. So it's important, and we look for an item on a future board agenda to discuss as to why the enrollment continues to drop, despite being better and less.
Thank you.
Just doesn't add up. Thank you.
Angie.
Now we're on to item 6C, which is the Summer School 2020 Plan Approval. Mike, would you like to introduce this?
You bet, yeah. Tonight we're seeking approval for our 2020 Summer School Plan. If you recall, at our last meeting, Monica Bianco, our Summer School Coordinator, was here to present an overview of that plan. We have not received any questions since that time, but we'll entertain any that you have at this time.
Scott?
I move approval of the 2020 summer school plan as presented.
Second.
My third.
Love it.
All right, we have a motion and a second. An enthusiastic second from the left. Is there discussion? Scott?
One thing, and for Mike, just I was really interested in hopefully the change that we can somehow move the registration of the, has the registration already been moved to Infinite Campus for this?
Changing the registration, yep, and also looking.
That's a future change, right? Coming this next year.
I have to double check on that.
Yeah, I can't remember.
Because we switched the process for registration last year. I can't remember if we switched the tool last year or this year. We got away from first come, first serve to getting everybody a chance to register and then a lottery, and our hope is that
and that's where I was going. I hope that we can leverage technology this year, and I know part of the plan presented, but so we can really try to anticipate the classes that are needed and match those kids up so they can do what they want. But
that's
I'm
cool.
Enthusiastic about support for some school.
Any more discussion? Is that a hand up? Shall we vote on the summer school plan? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That carries. First discussion item this evening is the enrollment projection report and the report of the facility planning task force. Hi, Chris.
Hey. Last year, we had a way back in 2019. We had a facility planning task force last year. So kind of strange orientation. But we had a facility. facility planning task force that made several recommendations, many of which have already been acted upon, and one of them was the creation of an annual process that would pull together a team of people who could analyze their current enrollments and future projections, and then consider any current or future impact on our facilities. And so in December, we held our first meeting of our facility enrollment committee, and we had 18 community members that either participated on 2019 Facility Planning Task Force or the 2016 Enrollment Balancing Task Force participated. So we started with those two groups because they had deep understanding of enrollments and enrollment projections, and that allowed us to have a pretty quick conversation about where we were at and then talk about the impact of enrollment. That was our approach to this number. So far longer than I've been in the district, we've been doing enrollment projections. And in 2016, the Enrollment Balancing Task Force created a more robust process. And based on that, the work of that team, we now consider birth rates, home sales, new developments, new housing developments, enrollment trends, market share, and how many potential students we might have that progress from birth to kindergarten. But even with all that information, the projection process is still not perfect. And so we, other factors that have impacted our ability to project include the economy. Not much control over that, but it certainly has an impact. Housing inventory, what we saw this year, slowed down some of our projections. And the ever-tough-to-forecast birth rate. Despite that, we continue to project because it's important for us, for many reasons, to have projections. We use them for staffing. We use them for financial forecasts. We use them for facility planning. And so we will keep at it. And in the last 3 years, we've had variances. We've been up from 170 over-projected to 100 or so under-projected. So that's the range. And with 7,300 students, it's not bad. The 98 to 102% percentile regarding projections to actuals, but we'll keep at it. So with that, I'm just going to present just a couple highlights from the committee's work. Not the entire presentation that was used during the committee's meeting, but it's available as part of this agenda item. But I'm just going to start. Enrollment highlights. And then questions. So our resident enrollment does continue to rise, which is always good news. Highest level since the 80s. Great. It's a really hard to read slide that shows just kind of the enrollment history since we became a district. And the red is open enrollments here. As open enrollment phases out, our resident enrollment not only increasing but replaces at a rate faster than non-resident students as they graduate from our system. So that's the first bullet. We did have an increase of 112 students last year. You'll see 726 student increase over the last 5 years. While I mentioned market share to us means our potential kindergarten through 12th grade students of resident students. So nearly 20% choose to attend a private or parochial school. But we have made great inroads there and captured more of that market share, almost 5% in the last 5 years from the private parochial market. So we increased again this past year by 0.6. That would be 35, 40 students market share. But overall, student population in the district was relatively flat. So about the same number of students in more than the private schools. maybe I'll point out just a few other slides. If you look, the facility planning task force spent most of its time last year analyzing elementary enrollments because that's where our growth is happening. And this is our birth rate data, which is elementary. I will point out that in 23-24 and 24-25, these are births that are known to us. Get this from the state of Wisconsin regarding who has been born in our attendance boundaries. You'll see we have births of 459 and 467, and those far outpace the total of just 7 years ago at 388. So we're 860, 70 births higher than just a few years ago, not even 7 years ago. So, and
those are known births in the 24-25.
Those are not projected.
Can't project those.
They have happened.
Yeah. We also, this is an interesting slide about home sales. You'll see the home sales decline here, which led us to over-projecting in 2018-19, and then didn't recover as fast as we could. And this is really because nobody's selling their house. I'll know that. The demand is there, the supply is not. So that's certainly having an impact on our ability to attract new families. Elementary, though, specifically, just to show you what we are projecting. So this is Brookfield Elementary, just so you understand the graph. This, on the left of this dotted line, the red dotted line, is past enrollment percent of capacity. And then the right of the line is projected enrollment capacity. And all of our elementaries now, except for one, are within 90%, are below 90% capacity. So, and our capacity starts at 90% capacity, so it's really 90%, which gives us some room.
Kind of a turducken going there.
Yes, there is.
So Burleigh is relatively flat for projections. Dixon, more like a Brookfield Elementary trajectory of being into the upper 80s. Swanson, like Burleigh, relatively flat, tops out at around 80%. Tonawanda continues to be our greatest priority as far as building capacity, which was why the board addition of the gymnasium last August, so that we could expand the capacity there, which is noted in this slide, sort of. We may adjust capacity once the gym is completed, so we may remain under 100%. We still anticipate the greatest growth to happen. Just really, we'll be watching that most closely. The committee did look at middle school and high school, and you can see those. They did not rise above 70. So I guess just to wrap this up and take questions, the facility enrollment committee, really the recommendation was just to continue the plan to start saving once we get past Tonawanda Gym and kind of turn the corner on the capital projects like the high school facilities and district office, that we begin to build up our capital reserves again, so that if we do hit capacity at any of our buildings, we have financial flexibility to respond to those. And the committee said, unless there is a significant disruptor. We did model this with four-year-old kindergarten as a potential disruptor to the system, and we still feel like we would fit given the current enrollments, projected enrollments, and then the addition of 4K. So the committee said that until something like 4K or economic disruptor or something else happens, really just saving, continuing to plan to save for the future.
on the report in the minutes, did you guys talk about modulars or anything like that? Like, was that part of the discussion? And if so, what were some of the thoughts around that?
Yeah, it was not. You know, the
color relocatables.
Right.
I think Gene prefers modulars.
The as our enrollment projections, even from last year to this year, have been reduced, even though Tonawanda is still at effectively over 100%, felt like we didn't need to get into specific conversations right now because that conversation looks like it could be 4 years at the earliest. So I think the logic behind really the recommendation to save is just to give us the flexibility when we get closer, 2 years out, closer to capacity, we can bring back all of the options and figure out which option is the best. All without.
Thank you. I just noticed that it wasn't an option on there or going forward, but I mean, obviously when the task force convenes, that'll be their discussion and then. Thank you. Scott?
Because our 100% capacity is really only 90% of the school, can a school, I mean, I know I've seen you and did some studies, but can a school really comfortably function at 100%? I mean, I think at that point it becomes large group spaces, cafeteria, gym.
I think hasn't always been about just fitting classroom. It's also considered the other pressures that are put on the system, from drop off, pickup to cafeteria, gym space to those, to even flexible learning space in the school. So I think we could make it work. I don't know if we want to make it work for year over year, but I think if we were to have a huge surge.
One of the things we noted was when we went over 100% at Swanson for about a year and a half, it put a significant amount of strain on the infrastructure of the building. Just keeping up with the cleaning and all of that was pretty substantial because you have kids everywhere.
So a follow-up question then is, have we looked at, you know, I don't know that we did it last year when I was part of the enrollment balancing task force, but have we looked at what would happen if it's just one student increasing class size, meaning our desks are pretty flexible spaces now, there are tables, I mean, to pull up a chair somewhere in that classroom or an extra, maybe fitting one kid in. I'm not advocating that, but, you know, a one or two student difference in the classes, that changed these numbers and then bringing in an aide or, you know, whatever other educational supports to make sure that teaching and learning is happening. Is that another? I'm just wondering if that's a viable strategy.
You know, the way we project by grade level isn't perfect either. So not everybody moves into third grade like we wanted them to.
They don't come in packets of 25.
Fifth grade like we wanted them to, you know, saying. So I think that could certainly be a strategy where we were at. Four-section school, Brookdale, or Dixon, where we had 105 students at third grade, rather than one five classrooms.
Given our laser-like focus on early literacy, we'd be interested in making sure our youngest learners don't have class sizes that approach the mid to upper 20s.
Sure. Well, I'm not advocating the approach, but I wonder again, to get over a hump or just a slight, I mean, you hate to bring on a school, open a school if we're just at the top of that curve and we're either going to plateau or decrease, you know, and so again, for a couple of years, I just wonder if that's a strategy we might, and again, it's down the road. I know that's not tonight.
Jen?
Here's two questions. One is the committee or planning task force. So after this conclusion, you're going to have some regular meeting to do that? Because I know it's not going to happen overnight because that's year by year. So it's not going to happen, say, next month, because nothing going to change.
Totally. I think the initial plan is to meet annually at minimum. And then if facility decisions or recommendations were needed, that committee would meet more for a series of months and then help guide the process. So I don't see that group getting together until next December when our projections are ready again. But again, should somebody's enrollment skyrocket and we needed to figure out which of our past recommendations should be prioritized, then maybe that would be the team to do it, and then they would do it.
All right, and then second question is, thank you. Looks like because there's so many uncertainties in there, because just like you said, so many variables, and no one knows what's going to happen. So wonder now, seems like to me, just like what I heard, that only one solution, we save money. Once we need, we build a new one. That's what I understood. But I wonder how to make that work. I know even though we say, let's say we have $40 million to build a brand new schools, but then you may have a school, but in a sudden, then enrollment is not going to go high anymore. So what are we going to do with that? So I wonder,
the task force,
only one solution or one option, there's no such interim solution. What if?
Yeah. I know that last year the task force recommended that priority recommendation for a five-year solution was to reopen the site. But also recognized that in order to make that kind of investment, we really needed to see multiple schools heading towards capacity. You know, and so right now, if we don't have that, you know, based on our 5-year projections, if it's only Tonawanda, that may take Hillside off the table for right now. And it may reprioritize one of the other interim solutions. Could be relocatables, could also be an addition to fixing.
Remodeling existing spacing and reallocation of already existing square footage, that's all in play.
I think the benefit to the value of the facility planning task force going through their prioritization process will help us down the road, because I think we put all the options on the table that should be considered, and then based on our enrollment numbers, we'll be able to just revisit those options, refresh the numbers, and try to get.
And we scaled back our enrollment projections, mainly because our housing market is just not producing new homes or sales like it was at one time not that long ago.
That's true. It's not predictable. That's why.
Right. The birth rate, births have happened. That number's a little more solid.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Glenn?
I had the opportunity to attend this meeting back in December, and I want to, I think I've said it here before, but just to say to Chris, I'm just very impressed with not only the thoroughness of the way that you're looking at it, but the way in which you conduct the meetings. You know, it's not been a the sky is falling approach. It's been, here's what we see, here's something to be concerned about, let's talk about it. You've done a good job of, I think, drawing input, and I think your responses here indicate trying to keep all the options on the table to address questions like, is this a bubble or is this a long-term thing? And just to keep monitoring as we go along. So I just want to thank you and Dr. Hansen for anticipating something that may never happen. But at least if it does, we will have prepared ourselves for it. So thank you very much.
I've been watching these numbers for well before I was on the school board, probably 12 or 14 years, looking at the predictions of enrollment. I used to be impressed that we were within plus or minus 2 for the overall number of students in the district. And I recall that after about 2 years, the accuracy of our projections fell off dramatically. Now
now we're at a point where we're forecasting down to the building level and still within that plus or minus 2%, and the projections are accurate a little farther out now, and I'm confident someday you will be predicting those births.
So you can really mess it yourself.
Our HCD curriculum is that good.
Well,
just went there.
Glenn.
But I'd also like to give credit to Jen Roskopf, who's in the audience here, who with Deb Nostad put together a much more robust projection model than we've had in the past. So thank you, Jen, for that.
It took us 3 years to figure it out, but you got it.
Thanks, Chris. Appreciate your time.
Next discussion item this evening is the verification of candidacy declarations for the Board of Education. And in the absence of the clerk, Mark is going to do that for us.
You bet. Declaration of candidacy forms, campaign registration statements, and nomination signatures for the following named persons have declared their candidacy for a member of the Board of Education of the School District of Elmbrook. All of this has been examined, and Christy Westfall can attest to the fact that she has verified these folks as having met the qualifications of candidates in Area 1 seat, Scott Wheeler, Area 3 seat, Jin Sun, and the at-large seat, Leanne Weed, Jen Roskopf, and Gisela Syed. All have qualified for being on the ballot, which means for the at-large seat, we will have a primary on February 18th in our community. Christy continues to work with the city and all the folks that need to make the ballots happen, so we are in a good place. With that, I'd open it up for any questions that folks may have.
Len?
Do you know if there are any plans to have any kind of forum of candidates?
There is. I believe it's tentatively scheduled February 10th in this room from 5 to 7. Looking at Christy. In the evening of February 10th. And once we have that confirmed, Parent Network will be facilitating that for us. And I've been in touch with Robin Rubenstein to make sure she has what she needs for that night. And Christy and I will work with that team to get that set up. So once we finalize that, we'll push that all out.
And what is the date for the primary again? 18th?
February 18th. Any other questions?
Thank you, Mark.
Yep.
Next item of business this evening is discussion of meeting dates for the board for the coming calendar year, school calendar year. Boy, this gets confusing. Beginning in July. The proposed dates are listed there in your document. Note that the July and August dates may change depending on the date of the move to the new office building. And, of course, these dates could be changed based on board member requests. So if you want to take these home, look at your calendar, come back with suggestions, or if you have suggestions now, please propose any changes to Mark or Christy within the next couple weeks so that we can get those pushed out on board docs in time for the next meeting. Scott?
Comment or question was, a year ago I suggested we look at about one meeting a month, and we did that, and I think it's worked out pretty well. I know September is different because we have the annual meeting required on that Monday by statute, so there's two in September, but I was curious about the two in October, if that could just be one. It takes a pretty good meeting to be no meeting.
I think we started doing those doubles in October because of the TLC schedule. There's just a lot of stuff coming through the pipeline at that point. You all don't feel that's necessary anymore.
What's the on the curriculum renewal?
Art, business ed,
612 art, family and consumer science. 612 business, 612 family and consumer science. So
a lot different than the last couple of years.
It'd be a little more robust.
But again, I mean, we're not talking about 40 classes there, or 40 UBDs, we're talking about a dozen, probably, right?
Yeah. The chair reads them all carefully.
I read and memorize. Can recite
and
to you.
And then he takes them. He takes the classes, too.
There's a pop quiz for the members.
Allison.
I think the question would be, would you rather just have one meeting, a longer meeting, or two meetings? So, something to consider. Might go a little bit longer, but...
Jen?
I kind of like the opportunity for the whole board meeting here. I noticed last year we had a significant more number of like a work session or workshop. I wonder that could be discussed in advance so we know the plan and subject, or versus kind of happen offline. Some of those are, I think, is great and helpful. So I wonder who can we talk about it before we set up this meeting? So then we know what subject we wanna get into more, or some of those maybe not necessarily.
Trying to remember at what point in the year we've settled those schedules typically.
So once we have the foundation of full board meetings, then we will plug in the months that we don't have two board meetings. We try to find a work session date that works for board members, and then we plug that in. Then Catherine, Scott, and I sit down and figure out what topics we want and plug them in based upon work that Mike, Chris, or Kristen are doing. So it matches. So if there's a big topic coming to FNL, it might be a work session before that, then FNO gets the issue, and then it gets to the full board. So it's typically a 2 to 3 month sequence for some of that big work. That's how the process is. So this is a foundation. Once these are solid, then we'll start plugging the rest of the stuff in, including committee meetings around that and all the other stuff.
Are we able to go through those, like subject versus say, this is a work session, this is a subject?
We could be more deliberate about pushing that information out to the board members and taking suggestions.
Mm-hmm.
We have to recognize a few times we've swapped things just because of things that were coming up in the district.
Yeah. Usually the first work session we have a conversation. You may recall we were in room 133 when we brainstormed 6 or 7 different topics. Some of those we won't get to this year, so then we could validate whether or not they're worth our time again. If we didn't get to them this year, we would bring them back as a higher priority. Yeah, we can certainly do that early on.
Good point.
Yep.
Make sure that work sessions are valuable to the board members. Glenn?
Just to piggyback on Jen's question, just reflecting, it seems like some of the work sessions, and I've found all of them to be valuable, some are more focused on education of the board, and some are more focused on issues, as you alluded to. So I think just having that conversation at some point about how much education and what topics and what issues do we see coming up, I think this team here can help us. You have a bigger picture, I think, than we do of that, to maybe at least start the conversation. So I appreciate your raising the question.
Appreciate
the
consideration.
Anything else on this topic? All right. That brings us to the president's report, which might be here somewhere. It's short tonight. Since the December board meeting, I've had the opportunity to attend band concert, the Swanson Dare graduation, meeting of the Teaching and Learning Committee, a St. Coletta holiday celebration at the Intergenerational Care Center, which is operating at Fairview South, and I met with a number of board and staff members. The long holiday break was an opportunity to do some reading or listening to books while doing something else. I read a biography of John Adams in his later years and one about Churchill in his first months as prime minister and a novella by John Steinbeck. The use of language was beautiful. I began volume 4 of Churchill's own History of the English-Speaking Peoples, also beautiful use of language and quite different from Steinbeck's. I read half of Range before the library loan expired. I'll get to the other half when I get a hold of the book again. The author of that book says it's useful to know a bit about many things because creativity and problem solving depend on our ability to make comparisons and analogies. And I'm currently reading The Second Mountain by David Brooks. I'll probably read this one again. Brooks makes a distinction between happiness and joy. He's in favor of both, says both are good, and suggests that they're part of life's natural progression. But he points out that happiness tends to be time-bound and related to specific events and accomplishments, and it's often focused on ourselves. Joy, on the other hand, is more durable and abiding. It's relational and comes from giving ourselves over to others and to our callings. The people and causes to which we are committed bring joy, not externally, but from the inside. Put another way, he says, you can be knowledgeable with other people's knowledge, but you can't be wise with other people's wisdom. Often we need to practice one in order to attain the other. That's my report for the evening. Which brings us to committee chair and liaison reports. F&O?
Nothing new beyond what we've already talked about this evening.
Teacher and learning.
We had a exciting meeting with a lot of people to listen to the family technology survey results. That agenda topic took us a little longer than we wanted, but there's some great next steps. You can review them in the agenda and the minutes from the meeting, but just a couple of highlights are the elimination of YouTube at middle school is being recommended by the district, and we're going to do a time study on how long kids are on their devices. So we're going to track some of the students and see how long they use their devices and for what, and survey the teachers a little more closely there. And then to communicate that out, another big takeaway from the survey was that 40% or so of our parents didn't really know how technology was used in the classroom, so just wanting to be a little more transparent as a next step so that families understand how we're using it. We were in the middle of a K-8 literacy update. It really ran out of time. That's going to be continued at a future Teaching and Learning Committee meeting, as well as the K-5 math update is coming on our February agenda item or agenda as an agenda topic, and so is the Ignite curriculum for February. So we're in the middle of these literacy and math updates, along with some of the root causes on the literacy side for what we see as opportunities and next steps for our literacy program in the district. So it's big work, it's important, and if any board members have questions, let me know, and certainly review those minutes. They might be of interest to board members. That's my report.
Thank you. Any questions for Scott? Are you able to fill in for personnel as well?
Oh, yes, I've got that. I've got an email from Jean, so I'll read this pretty close to how she wrote it, and maybe we can include it with the board docs. In September 2019, the board adopted a district goal to increase the staff engagement index, that's positive responses, to 80%, and get a 50% participation rate by April 2020, which is when that survey is given, so that would be this coming survey that we're planning on administering. To that end, Chris Thompson and Pam Casey and Kristen Sobosinski recommended that we use Qualtrics, a third-party vendor, to survey and handle our district surveying needs. This wouldn't just be the staff engagement survey, but it would also be the family survey. Chris said there were about 8 different surveys that we currently use internal surveys for, but it would be administered by a third party. They follow up on it. They remind the people to take it. There are not any identifiers given to the district. We just get compiled results and the comments back. We did look at Qualtrics' survey of employees, which would be the teachers. They have a survey that's similar. A lot of the questions are the same. We feel like there's some great features that it's third party versus in-house, so that might increase the response rate if some teachers, were nervous about being honest on a survey or might know what they were saying. strong analytics, they're going to do that. That's going to take a bit of burden off of our team because they dive into it and they've got PhDs, people working on it. And we have the ability to compare to other companies around the world, including some school districts in our region. Mequon Thanesville uses this vendor, Waukesha does, and Franklin. So the committee unanimously approved this third-party vendor. There's an annual cost for that and unlimited number of surveys that we can use that for. But the first one we'll be using for is the staff engagement survey in April. We also looked at the educator E3 compensation model. It's been in place since 2015. It's under review by a committee of teachers and leaders. Gene Lambert participates on that as chair of the personnel committee. They so far surveyed staff and leaders and completed a review of that E3 process and prioritized some areas for improvement. That includes our salary ranges. We're falling a little bit behind our benchmarks in certain areas, and so we want the review's been completed, and we're talking about next steps there, leveling up. That's the process by which a teacher moves in their bands to the next salary band. There's 5 of them currently, so reviewing that process and making a recommendation there. It would be possible to give raises within the bands. They're looking at that issue, and also a recommendation for an expansion of the professional development into another tier in the compensation model. So right now, professional development is kind of a bonus that you get it, but then it's gone the following year, and so they're looking at what to do with that. So there will be a full recommendation coming to the personnel committee in March, and then on to the board here in March or April. One other thing. We did review the personnel committee scorecard. I got a healthcare update. Our healthcare costs are trending a little higher compared to a year ago because of some high cost claims. So we'll continue to monitor that. And that's my report.
Thank you.
Or Jean's report, to be more accurate.
Are there questions for Scott? All right. CLE, Allison.
Well, we did not have a very robust meeting, but we did have some fun visitors. We met the school resource officers at both Brookfield East and Brookfield Central. Officer Stephanie Zartner is Brookfield East school resource officer, and Tony Cater is Brookfield Central's school resource officer, and they are both excited about their positions, and the staff and students are still getting to know them, but very positive feedback, and I understand that they're already very busy at both our high schools. So we're really excited about that. And then Mark was able to give us a legislative update about some possible education bills that may be coming through. So if you have any questions, ask Mark, because he knows all of that information. That's all.
Thank you.
It's one of those legislative items, school start dates. And when did the resource officer start? I knew it would be sometime in January, but I didn't know.
January 2nd.
Oh, was it? Right when we came back from break. Outstanding.
They were firmly in their offices on January 2nd, but they had been in the building for weeks on occasion, in and out of buildings for weeks ahead of that.
Nice.
Yeah, and really well received.
I was so excited when I said it changed to August. I thought it may be something already determined, but now it's not.
That was one of my dreams.
We'll keep working at it.
It's out of my control.
Are there liaison updates? Allison?
The GTPAO had a meeting this week where we invited students that have been accepted to colleges come as a panel, as well as some alumni interviewers for students. And Jen Sun was part of the panel and gave us really good information on how to prepare your students for college and to get into their colleges. I think that the overall message was that Elmbrook really prepares students for college and that they are well received at the colleges they apply to.
Thank you. Are there other liaison reports? Superintendent's report.
call your attention to the back of the boardroom. We have some new student art on display. That is from Mrs. Madsen's class at Burleigh Elementary School. A little write-up that's similar. You can see it interspersed between the pictures. So feel free to get a chance. It's a neat little project that Mrs. Madsen did. Congratulations to all of our students who were involved in the holiday concerts and performances. That stretch right before we get on winter break and Christmas break is a pretty busy stretch for our kids who are in any of our performing groups, choir, band, orchestra. I got a chance to see some incredible concerts. What our kids do this time of year is just another extension of all of the really amazing things they do during the course of the year. So congratulations to all of the kids, all of the people who lead those student groups, and all the parents that drive their kids back and forth to countless practices. A couple superintendent video updates that have been well received. We did a video update right before the holidays, and then we just launched a safety video last week. Some great feedback from families, parents, community members, kids. So I really appreciate Eric Hagan, who helps us produce those videos. There are a couple of other things on the written superintendent report. That concludes my report, but if folks have questions or comments or feedback.
Thank you, Mark. Looking ahead to our February 11th meeting, projected action items include the meeting schedule for the 2020-2021 Board of Education year. Projected discussion items are the second Friday in January enrollment report, state education convention reports, policy reviews, and the usual committee and liaison updates. Do we have any announcements this evening?
One, I'm going to the state education convention, I think Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. So if anyone wants to be down there, you can grab lunch or right here.
Looks like we're all going.
Are you going, Allison?
I am not.
You went past by the agenda too fast for me, but I think we may be having the guaranteed maximum price come on the agenda for the athletic facilities. So you might take a look at that.
Okay. We have a motion to adjourn.
Hello? Second.
All in favor of adjourning, please say aye.
Aye.
We are adjourned.